receive. Whenever the Lord wants to bless a man, the first thing God considers is to give a seed to that man. Because seed are expected to be worked upon. That's why God does not give you fruit first. He gives you seed first. And what you make do of that seed is what will either bless you or destroy you. It's that seed that will transform or change your story as you carefully use them. The significance of seed. Let's look at Genesis chapter 8. Genesis chapter 8, verse 22. Genesis chapter 8. I don't know why we are all on blue this morning. It depicts love, she?
Yes.
Because I can see somebody chasing me everywhere with love.
Multiply it.
You have to multiply it, and then your seed will give you dominion. Let us look at Genesis chapter 26 from verse 1. What God said to Isaac. Genesis 26 from verse 1. Now there was a famine in the land besides the earlier famine of Abraham's time, and Isaac went to Abimelech, king of Philistines, in Gerar. Verse 2. The Lord appeared to Isaac and said, do not go down to Egypt. Live in the land where I tell you to live. Verse 3. Stay in this land for a while, and I will be with you, and I will bless you. Stay in this land for a while. I will be with you, and I will bless you. For to you and your seeds, for to you and your descendants, I will give all these lands and will confirm the oath I swore for your father, to your father Abraham. I will make your descendants your seeds, as numerous as the sun, as the stars in the sky, and will give them all these lands, and through your offspring, all nations of the earth will be blessed. Through your seeds, all nations of the earth will be blessed. Because Abraham obeyed and kept my requirements, my commandments, my decrees, and my laws. If you look at this scripture, God was talking to Isaac. God cannot bless Isaac beyond his normal self. God cannot expand Isaac. But he can expand Isaac through his seeds. He said, Isaac, I will bless you and bless your seeds, and your seeds will dominate the earth. Your seed will bless the entire human race. But Isaac in himself was limited. Why? Because Isaac cannot be multiplied. Isaac cannot be multiplied, but his seeds can multiply. So if you look at Genesis, let's look at Genesis chapter 1 from verse Genesis chapter 1 from verse 25. Let's look at from verse 25 or 24 rather. From verse 24. And God said, let the land produce living creatures according to their kinds. Let the land produce living creatures according to their kinds. Livestock, creatures that move along the ground, and wild animals, each according to his kind. According to their kinds. Verse 25. God made the wild animals according to their kind, the livestock according to their kinds, and all the creatures that move along the ground according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. 26. Then God said, let us make man in our image, in our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, over livestock, over the earth, and over all creatures that move along the ground. Verse 27. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created the male and female, he created them. Verse 28. God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful, multiply, increase, subdue, and then have dominion. Verse 29. Then God said, I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth, and every tree that has fruit with seed in it. Every tree that has fruit with seed or seed in it. They will be yours for food. Amen. Let's stop there. Every tree that has seed in it. And as we are human in the image and the likeness of God, God attracts in us seeds also to dominate the earth. If you look at verse 28, the Bible says, and God said, 25, God said, let us, 26, let us make man in our image. Let us make man in our image. In the image of God, he created the male and female. And when God wanted to create the entire human race, he only created two species of humans. One, Adam. Then from Adam came Eve. And in Adam were trapped over 7 billion people. God did not have to create 7 billion. But there were seeds of human race trapped in Adam. And of course, from Adam, we are here today by the grace of God. How do we convert our seeds to tree? How do you make yourself relevant on earth? I'm using both trees, let me say agriculture, and I'm using it to depict human race. For a seed to become a tree, for a man to become relevant on earth. Number one, you must first of all find the seed. You must first of all find the seed. If I want to plant cassava, or if I want to plant mango, I have to first of all look for what? Mango seed. That's why the Bible says every tree has a seed in it. And in the seed, you have the trees. And in the trees, you have forests. In every tree is a seed. And in those seeds, you have trees. And in the trees, you have forests. So if I want to plant a mango tree, I have to go first of all to look for a mango seed. I have to look for the right seed that is applicable to me. I have to go look for that tree or the seed that is applicable to me. So the right seed is very, very important. If you want to be relevant on earth, you have to look for that right seed trapped inside of you that can dominate the earth, that can make you relevant on earth. We have so many examples all around us, in the football world, in the lawn tennis world, in all these places, we have different manifestations of seeds that have become fruit. And those fruits are what we see everywhere. No wonder the Bible says, by their fruit you shall know them. Nobody can manifest anything without first of all thinking of it. There is nothing you can do without first of all considering it in your heart. And that which you have trapped in your heart is called the seed. And when you begin to water that seed in your heart, it becomes your fruit that all men will see. It becomes your personality. It becomes your way of life. So you have to look for the right seed to plant. Number two, you have to look for the right environment where you can plant your seed. You don't just plant seeds anyhow. Mango trees have their seasons and they have places where they grow. They have places where they grow. The same with cocoa tree. If you want to plant cocoa, you want to harvest plenty cocoa, you want to harvest cocoa bountifully, you can't come and plant it in Agungi. You are wasting your time. So you have to go look for the right location where cocoa tree can grow. There are some seeds that can germinate anywhere. E.g.
mango,
maize,
beans.
Even beans has special places where they can grow better. So you don't just plant seed anywhere. You must look for the right environment where you can plant your seed. Number three, it requires a conscious effort to be planted in the ground. For that seed to become tree, it requires a conscious effort to be planted in the ground. If you hold a seed in your hands, the seed cannot grow in your hands. No matter how beautiful that seed is, it cannot grow in your hands. Because your hands cannot or will not allow the seed to grow. So you have to look for the right environment, and it requires a conscious effort to dig the ground and put the seed there. You know, there are some seeds that you just crack the surface of the land and drop, and it will grow. There are some that you have to dig before, you know, it can grow, before you can plant them. So you have to use your effort to plant the seed. What number am I now? Number four. The seed must be isolated. It means the seed will be lonely. Once you plant the seed, is left alone. The seed has to be isolated. And for the period that the seed is isolated, it goes through a lot. I've tried something before in those days that we used to do some farming behind our backyard. You know, you are curious, you are anxious for your seed to grow fast. So we go there, we'll be checking the seed every time. Put the beans in the ground, and you're always going there because you have isolated it. So you're always going back there to check, when will this thing grow? We water it, we do all sorts of things and everything. And then sometimes, if something is not coming out on time, what do? You dig it up. You dig it up. Say, what is wrong with this thing? Maybe it's not the right place. You want to. By the time you dig it up and look at it, you will see that it has decayed. It's no longer the same thing that you kept or you planted in the ground. So the seed is isolated. What am I saying? There are times that you have to be isolated. There are times that you have to be lonely. There are times that it seems as if nothing is working for you. You have to be isolated. Number five. The reason for your isolation is because your seed has to go through germination. The seed has to germinate. And when the seed is germinating, you know, it goes through some pains, and we feed on the seed and a lot of things, you know, fighting in the ground with the seed. But despite the fact that the seed dies, does not mean it won't grow. It does not matter what it is that you are going through today, it's just seasonal. You will soon come out of it. It may look as if it's tough. It may look as if it's rough now. Maybe you are planted. You know, God planted you here so that you go through the process of growth. Some of us don't want to change. We want to continue to live in our old nature, our normal way of living. You can't reach the top with your normal living. You can never reach the top in life. You can never be relevant on earth with your normal styles of living or ideology. You can't reach the top with what you were fed from your former environment. You can reach the top with your belief system. So God had to interrupt what you believe. God had to interrupt your ideas because he wants to bring the best out of you. That's why some of us go through pain. And some of us expect manifestation quickly. Some of us run into churches expecting God to perform magic, to bless us quickly, so that we can become something quickly. No, it goes through stages. Growth has steps and stages. For you to become something big, God has to first of all drill you. You have to be planted. You have to be isolated. You have to germinate from the ground. And number six, the seed had to die. Paul said, I die daily. You have to die to flesh. You have to die to fornication. You have to die to anger. All these things require conscious effort. I see people praying, God, take my anger away. It's a wrong prayer. God will not take your anger away because he didn't give it to you in the first place. You got it from the environment where you were planted. You got it from there. Yes, anger is a seed trapped inside of you, don't forget it. But it's a virtue. It's meant to provoke you to relevance. It's meant to provoke you to be the best in life. It's meant to propel you to tell yourself that my life will not continue like this. I will be a better person. That's what anger is meant for. Not to destroy, not to kill. Anger shouldn't lead you to unforgiveness. I am angry and you can't forgive. And the Bible says you should not allow sun to set on your anger. Meaning you can be angry because it's a virtue. But it must be corrected. And how can this be corrected? You have to die. You must die. This morning I woke up and something, let me say Holy Spirit, because when something is telling you something good, then it has to be Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. And it couldn't have been my mind. What I had was, there are three major things that destroys man. I said, okay, what are they? I said, number one is money. Number two is power. And number three is sex. I said, okay, I've had that before. So what's new about it? He said, because money leads to pride, and God is the one that resists the proud. He said, power corrupts the mind and equally leads to pride, and God is the one that resists the proud. I said, how about sex? He said, the only sin that the Lord spoke about specifically in the Bible that you should not indulge in is sex. That's Corinthians 3:16. Know ye not that your body is the temple of God? Know ye not that your body is the temple of Almighty God. So when you violate your body, you have violated the rules of God concerning his temple. So that is why we are expected to keep our body. Keep it pure. Because the only sin that it costs against your body is what? Immorality. Sexual immorality. That you can't deny. If I say, Sarah is wearing green, I say, no, it's not green, it's blue. I say, Pastor, you said Sarah is wearing green. I can quickly change that. I didn't say green, I said blue. You can't hold it against me because I said it. You can't even argue. Because if God particles say, he will ask you, why are you now arguing? Is that green? Is that blue? At least you are wearing blue, so it's blue. We move. I can deny it. But if I commit sexual immorality with Sarah, she can't deny it. And I can't deny it. And it has date. It has time. It even has time of the mind, that the mind agreed in it. So it's recorded. 20 years later, if I see Sarah married, that time, that date, will just pop up immediately. If I touch Sarah, immediately her mind will go back to that date. At that time that they had something to do again. So it can't be denied. It can't be denied. And I've equally seen that is the ground for covetousness. When I say covetousness, that you attract more demons into your body. Because once you are joined with a lady who has slept with a man, you can see the seed. You can see the germination. Who has slept with a man or another man or maybe three men, and you have come to join the league, the spirits of those three men are transferred to you. The spirits of those three men that she has slept with, because women are incubators, they receive to multiply times two. So once you lay with this one, all the spirits times two, times two, times two. If she has slept with three people, three times two, two, two. Three demons or six demons are coming into your life. So once they possess you and you move to lay with another woman, you will transfer six demons to that woman. And if she, that's how the seed will continue to germinate and will continue to dominate the world. So these three major things, we have to be conscious of them. We have to be careful of them, because all the sins in the world are centered around those three. Every sin in the world is centered around these three. You can't escape any one of them. If you don't like women, you will love money, or you will like money. And if you, I have not seen anyone, shall. Who will say, I don't like money? I have not seen. And I have never seen anyone who says, I don't want to have a bite of power. Everyone wants to exercise it. In your marriage, you want to exercise it over your wife. If you are not loving it over your wife, over your children, you just want everybody to know that I am the one. Even in the manifestation of our gifting, sometimes when we come to sing, you know, I have discovered that people just want to show that, hey, I have this thing. Indirectly, it's power. Indirectly, style you want to show, anything that wants to show, is simply the exhibition of art. And God is the one that receives the crown. No wonder the Bible says that with their mouth and their lips they worship me. He said, but their heart is far from me. You can sing, you can worship, and your mind is somewhere else, or you are thinking of something else. So your seed had to die. What I'm doing now, I am deliberately dying to some things. I am deliberately and consciously dying to some things. When I say die, it means you must impose discipline on yourself. You must consciously and deliberately impose discipline on yourself, because you were made in the image and in the likeness of God. And he has an expected end that he has prepared for you. And the only way by which you can get there is to be conscious of what you carry. And you have to look around yourself to search for your limitations and begin to consciously work on them. Number 7, am I correct? The seed must consistently be watered. If you want your seed to grow, you have to go water it. If you want to grow, you need the word of God. You can only grow with what you know about God. You have to be feeding every day on the word. Psalm 1 from verse 2, the Bible says, the delight of the man is in the law of the Lord, and in the law of the Lord he meditates day and night. He said, it shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of waters that brings forth its fruit in due season. Now look at the seed that brings forth its fruits. His delight was in the law of the Lord, and in the law of the Lord he meditates day and night. It shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in due season, whose leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. You want to grow? You want to become something in life? You need clear direction from the word of God. Give me Joshua 1:8. Joshua 1:8. Don't allow this word to depart out of thy mouth. Because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. What you have in your mind is what you say. What you have there, what you have downloaded there, is what you say. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do, that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous. And then have what? For then you will make your way prosperous. And then have good success. Have good success. The word of God is paramount. The word of God is important for growth. If you want to grow in the spirit, even in the flesh, you need to consistently feed on the word of God. 2 Timothy 2:19 says, nevertheless, the foundation of the word of God standeth sure. The foundation of the word of God cannot be tamed. The Bible says, not even a jot of my word will go unfulfilled. So that is why your destiny is tied around the Word of God. You cannot become anything out of the Word of God. That's why the Bible says, in my image you were made. In my likeness I made them male and female. And by the grace of God, I pray for somebody here. The grace of God will come upon you.
Amen.
You will be conscious of what you carry.
Amen.
I said you will be conscious of what you carry.
Amen.
Because the world is waiting for what you carry. That's why you must become a forest. That's why you must be relevant in life. Because the world is waiting for everything that you carry. Have you ever seen a mango tree eat a mango tree? Please. Have you ever seen a mango tree eating a mango tree? But people feed on mango trees. So the mango tree is not meant for itself, it's meant for the people. That is why it's important for you to manifest. Because you are not blessed for you are blessed for the world. That's why the Bible says the children of the world eagerly and anxiously are waiting your fruits. They are waiting for your fruit so that their lives will be meaningful. If you don't manifest, do you know how many people will die in ignorance? Do you know how many nations will be destroyed? That is why it's expedient, it's important for us, for me and you to manifest. So whatever money God has given to you, the money is not for you. It's meant for others. It's meant to propagate the gospel. Whatsoever gift God has given to you is not for you. It's for others to find their way back to God. The earlier the better you pick this up, the good for you. And my prayer is that the Lord will help us to finish strong in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you. We bless your name for your grace upon us that will not turn to disgrace. We pray that the seed that you have given to us by your grace shall be turned to fruit, and the fruit will be blessings to the world. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen.
You're holy, God has told you.